Hi guys, welcome back to The Storm in the Cellar. Today we're going to take a look at one of the most outstanding movies of World War II, 12 O'Clock High. A classic movie about the 918th Bomb Group of the 8th Air Force. This is one of the best movies on leadership around. It's so good that it's still taught at the U.S. Air Force Squadron Officer School, Officer Training School, and Harvard Business School. So let's take a look at clips from 12 O'Clock High, and I'll give you my comments to it as we go along.
Where'd you get this?
An auction at Archbury, sir.
I'll take it.
That one's been knocked around a bit, sir. I have a fine Staffordshire.
No. I'll take this one. How much?
Only 10 shillings, sir. I'm afraid it's not much value.
Value? I want you to pack it carefully. Very carefully.
As you say, sir.
The famous Toby jug, or mug, as seen in the movie, stemmed from World War I British pilots, and they used to have it in their officers' club. It always faced towards the wall in the officers' club until an air tasking order dropped to fly a combat mission. Mine is a limited edition replica of the original prop in the movie. The original mug was given to General Frank Armstrong, who is the inspiration for the character of General Savage, played by Gregory Peck. It was Armstrong heirloom until it was stolen from his home in early 90s sometime and was never seen again, which was very sad. Even today, U.S. Army Air Force B-17 fields, which are covered over grown cow fields now, are dotted all over the English countryside. The Brits are really big on preserving and keeping aviation. That's pretty cool.
We mustn't go back.
Easy with his right leg. It's broken.
Got it.
Easy now.
You have to hold him.
We got
to
get back.
I've been sitting on him.
Bomber crews flew daylight precision bombing, which increased their bomb accuracy, made them huge targets from anti-aircraft flak and Luftwaffe fighter aircraft. As a result, they sustained extremely high battle damage on nearly every mission they went on.
I guess I'm coming.
But
Justin's dead.
Oh, I didn't know. I'm sorry. Well, we might as well get this out of the way. Sit down. Where did you first encounter enemy action?
Bishop, leave him alone. He's had enough today.
Mission briefings and debriefings are critical, but for obvious reasons, you can imagine how hard debriefings were after you've seen your buddies get killed in action.
With the three new ones and working the crews all night, Sergeant Nero thinks we can have 18.
How many of the other groups putting up?
21 apiece, sir.
You better camp on Nero's tail. No. He says 18, he's giving us everything with wings still on it.
What the other groups lose today?
Two in the 9/16th, zero in the others.
Our stinking luck. Those flak gunners had the range good by the time we made our run. What about crews, Doc?
I could give you a couple of different answers on that, sir.
Worrying about me, Doc, only don't. What about the rest of them?
That brings us to the two answers. On that list of 28 men asking to be excused from tomorrow's mission, three times more than normal. They give a lot of reasons. Colds, mostly. And most of them haven't got colds. And that doesn't mean that they've suddenly gone yellow. It just means that they're getting their bellies full. Now, do I okay them physically and mock them duty? How much can a man take? What's physical and what isn't?
The rules say a man ought to go right up to the point where he may endanger his crew. I wish I knew what that meant. If I did, I'd tell you.
Well, can you tell me this?
Here's where we start seeing Colonel Davenport's excuses for failure. The other groups are putting up more aircraft and suffering less losses than the 918th crews are. And the crews are looking for reasons not to fly.
The real trouble is, Frank, and it isn't formation.
Shoot.
It isn't down in the groups either. It's up here where a bunch of boys get to be nothing but a set of numbers. That's what's the trouble.
Do they know up here what my boys have been taking for 3 days in a row? That they'll be up again all night to get 18 in the air for tomorrow? How much do you think they can take? Do you know they're falling asleep at briefing? Are you going to drive them till they crack?
Take it easy, Keith.
Take it easy. Bomber Command can take it easy. Those boys are flesh and blood. They'll die for you, but they've got to have a chance, and they know they haven't got one. Frank, they can add. They know a man's chances run out in 15 missions. Somebody's got to give them a limit, a goal, some hope of living. What do you guys think they're made of?
Look, Keith.
Yes, sir?
Just got the reports from the groups. Go on up, Frank.
I'll be there in a minute, sir. Those things are coming, Keith. Replacements. Combat limits. But right now, the deal is to hang on. And look, Keith, you've got to find a way to save yourself a little. You can't carry all the load. It's too big.
Don't worry about me. If you want something to worry about the crews.
As you can see plainly, that Davenport's holding on way too tight. The crews that he's lost are getting to him, and he's no longer thinking operationally at all.
Let's have it with the bark on.
Well, you won't like it. I don't. It's the group commander.
Keith?
Well, it's always the group commander. It's his job, isn't it?
A little funny coming from you. He's your friend.
I didn't ask you to ask me.
I didn't mean it to sound like that, Frank.
It's okay.
I don't believe it, though. I don't think I do. On paper, Keith looked to me like the best group commander we've had. He's flown every mission. He gets more loyalty out of his men than anybody. Courage, he works hard. I don't know where to fault him. If a man like that can't cut it, we're in trouble. What happened downstairs to change the picture for you?
Nothing. Added this to it, though. He's gonna bust wide open. And he's gonna do it to himself, too. Why? Because he's a first-rate guy. Because those are his boys, and he's thinking about them instead of missions. Over-identification with his men. I think that's what they call it. And you aren't going to change it, either.
Savage has identified the problem in the group. He surmised that it was Davenport's loyalty to his men and not to the group.
We were 3 minutes late over the target and got most of it here on our bombing run.
That was a deadly 3 minutes, Keith. The whole idea was to get all the groups over the target simultaneously in a different altitude so that enemy flak couldn't concentrate on any one group.
Well, we sure were sitting ducks out there alone. Maybe I shouldn't have tried the target, but we were there and I figured the boys wouldn't want to bring their loads back home.
No man makes a perfect plan, Keith. You couldn't foresee a plane breaking through the runway. Maybe the mistake lay in not going on to the secondary target once you were late.
But I figured we could make up the time, catch up with the other groups. We could have, too, if it hadn't been for our stinking luck.
Luck? What luck was that?
It wasn't luck, sir. It was my fault.
It wasn't anybody's fault.
I'd like to hear the lieutenant's version.
Yes, sir. We had to alter the navigation and flight, sir, to cross the enemy coast here. We picked up an error, wind change. And I missed a checkpoint here, San Lo. By the time I caught it here, it ran, it had cost us 3 minutes. We never made it up.
If there's any fault, it's mine, sir. I was in command. I ordered the change in flight plan. The weather was thick enough, it could have happened to anyone.
Keith, I know you're tired, but let's talk a little. Sit down. Let's talk about luck. A pretty critical 3 minutes, Keith. 5 crews, 50 men.
Do you think I don't know?
I know you do. Whose fault was it, Keith?
I told you, sir. Primarily, it was mine.
Were you flying?
Yes, sir.
Do you fly and navigate, too, or do you rely on your navigator?
You have to rely on your navigator, but after all...
Then it was the lieutenant's fault.
He missed the checkpoint, but it could have happened to anyone.
I know, and I allow he feels as rotten about it as any of us do. More so, maybe. But what happens now, Keith?
I don't understand you, sir.
We're talking about luck. I don't believe in it. I believe that to some degree a man makes his own luck. Yours has been pretty bad down here, and it's getting worse, not better. Maybe the navigator's in point. He blew it. What are you going to do about it?
General, I don't believe in chopping off heads because of one mistake. I just don't think that's any way to run a group.
I feel sorry for the boy, Keith. But what are the men in your group going to be thinking about the next mission he navigates? That he messed up the San Nazaire mission. It's just that much more load on them, and one day if they fall apart on you, that won't be luck.
There isn't a man in the outfit who wouldn't stake his life on Zimmy. General, if it was anyone else but him, he's got 2 strikes against him to begin with. You don't realize, sir, that boy's got a persecution complex. He wants to fly every mission, trying to live down the fact that his parents were mixed up in the German-American Bund. They screened Zimmy plenty before he ever got overseas. That's what's riding him now.
Keith, good navigators is the one thing we're not short of. If you decide that you ought to relieve this boy, I'll give you a good replacement.
You might as well ask me to stand him up against the wall and shoot him in the back. No, I won't do it, sir. I just can't do it to him. I won't.
Keith, I want you to get to bed. Have the flight surgeon give you a shot that'll make you sleep 24 hours. Guess a man only has so much to give, and I guess you've given it. Effective now, you are relieved of this command, and you will report to me for duty at Bomber Command. I'll send someone down to take over here.
Another example of bad luck. And, of course, Davenport's propensity to take every screw-up by his airmen onto his own shoulders.
Soldier?
No, sir.
Then why are you admitting me to this station?
I saw it was a staff car, sir.
Goering could have been in it. There's my AGO card.
General may proceed, sir.
Soldier, this is a military post, not a zoo. From now on, you'll check everyone who enters, and without exception. Take a good look at me. If you or any man on this post passes me up again without saluting, even if I'm a block away, you'll wonder what fell on you. You might pass that word around.
Yes, sir.
Well, it's obvious that Savage has replaced Davenport as group commander, and he makes his new leadership known immediately with this MP. So you can expect more of the same as you go along.
How do I address you?
I don't think I quite understand the general, sir.
What's your rank? How am I supposed to know?
Sergeant McElhenney, sir, U.S. Army Air Forces.
It's Private McElhenney now. Where's the air exec?
I don't think he's on the station, sir. He left right after Lieutenant Zimmerman's funeral.
Zimmerman?
Yes, sir. Navigator, sir.
And what happened to him?
Suicide, sir.
Now, where's the ground exec?
In the hospital, sir. Mumps.
And the adjutant?
I think maybe Major Stovall's at the officer's club, sir.
Now, when you get your clothes on, find him. And ask him to report to me here.
Yes, sir. Stovall, sir, group adjutant.
Yes, I remember you, Major. You the only one around?
Probably, sir. I presume you've come down to take over the group.
That's right. You've been drinking, Major?
I have. It's the first time I've been drunk in 20 years. But it may not be the last.
Where's the air exec?
I don't know, sir. It's only an opinion, but I think it's possible. He may be drunk too, sir.
I'll take straight answers, Major. Is he off the station?
Yes, sir.
Where?
I don't know that, sir.
Send the MPs out and find him and bring him to me under arrest.
Does the general mean under actual arrest?
Exactly. Two, cancel all leaves and passes and make sure that all squadron commanders are back here by tonight. Three, bring me the personnel files, the 66-1s on Gately and the key staff. Including yours.
Yes, sir.
Four, set up a meeting for all combat crews in the briefing room tomorrow morning at 0800.
Is that all, sir?
It's abundantly clear that no one is in charge of the group since Davenport's relief of command. And Savage hits the ground running here as a leader.
Ask the general why I've been placed under arrest.
No. Stand at attention. You're the son of Lieutenant General Tom Gately, aren't you?
I believe that's my standard identification, sir.
What do you think of him as an officer?
None better, sir.
That's right. You're the son of one fine officer and the grandson of another. You're a graduate of West Point with 9 years' service. Your Form 5 shows that you have more four-engine time than any man in the group. For those reasons, you could have done more than anybody to take the load off Colonel Davenport. The record shows that you've flown only 3 missions since you've been here. Is that right?
If you don't count twice, I turn back, sir.
I take it that you don't even care about the part you had in breaking one of the best men you'll ever know. Add to it, as air exec, you were automatically in command here the moment Colonel Davenport left. And you met that responsibility exactly as you met his need. You ran out on it. You left the station to get drunk. Gately, as far as I'm concerned, you're yellow. A traitor to yourself, to this group, to the uniform you wear. It would be the easiest course for me to transfer you out. To saddle some unsuspecting guy with a deadbeat. Maybe you think that's what you're going to get out of this, a free ride in some combat unit. But I'm not going to pass the buck. I'm going to keep you right here. I hate a man like you so much that I'm going to get your head down in the mud and trample it. I'm going to make you wish you'd never been born.
If that's all, sir.
I'm just getting started. You're going to stay right here and get a belly full of flying. You're going to make every mission. You're not air exec anymore. You're just an airplane commander.
And I want you to paint this name on the nose of your ship. Leper Colony. Because in it, you're going to get every deadbeat in the outfit. Every man with a penchant for head colds. If there's a bombardier who can't hit his plate with his fork, you get him. If there's a navigator who can't find the men's room, you get him, because you rate him. Is that clear?
General Savage, I have a right to file charges against you for personal abuse and exceeding your lawful authority, and
no, get me Pine Tree. I want General Pritchard.
Line's busy, sir. Will you wait?
Yeah, I'll wait. Right, Gately. You've got a right to explain to General Pritchard cowardice, desertion of your post, a yellow streak a mile wide. And maybe he can explain it to your father so that they'll both be proud of you.
Hello.
You can tell him right now.
Hello. Hello, I have your line, sir. Hello.
General Savage.
Hello.
I withdraw my statement.
Hello.
Lieutenant Colonel Gately, who was second in command, took one of the best butt chewings ever made by a commander to his subordinate. There's a bombardier who can't hit his plate with his fork, or a navigator who can't find the men's room. You get him. That is classic.
Practice mission at 1100 this morning. That's right, practice. I've been sent down here to take over what has come to be known as a hard luck group. Well, I don't believe in hard luck. So we're going to find out what the trouble is. Maybe part of it's your flying, so we're going back to fundamentals. But I can tell you now one reason I think you've been having hard luck. I saw it in your faces last night. I can see it there now. You've been looking at a lot of air lately. You think you ought to have a rest. In short, you're sorry for yourselves. Now, I don't have a lot of patience with this what are we fighting for stuff. We're in a war, a shooting war. We've got to fight. And some of us have got to die. I'm not trying to tell you not to be afraid. Fear is normal. But stop worrying about it. And about yourselves. Stop making plans. Forget about going home. Consider yourselves already dead. Once you accept that idea, it won't be so tough. Now, if any man here can't buy that, if he rates himself as something special, with a special kind of hide to be saved, he'd better make up his mind about it right now. Because I don't want him in this group. I'll be in my office in 5 minutes. You can see me there.
Great entrance by Savage. He looks like a leader as he stands in front of the group and tells them just like it is. Consider yourself already dead is key to effectiveness in combat. But obviously, the air crews aren't buying Savage as their leader yet, and are still loyal to Davenport.
Yes, sir. It's costing me money.
How long are they going to keep you in here?
The doc said 10 days.
Well, you let me know if I can do anything.
Thanks, General.
I want to say, Birdwell, you got all that flak out of you yet?
Just about, sir. Doc didn't need no mind detector to find it, neither.
You getting enough chow?
Oh, just living in the tall cotton, sir.
How are you feeling, Ben?
I'm okay, General.
I was sorry to hear about your bad luck.
Thank you, sir.
Well, I see Doc didn't waste much time. Oh, excuse me, Ben. Well, that's pretty sensitive, huh?
That's okay, General. Go ahead and sit down.
Oh, I'd rather stand. I've been piling up more sitting time than flying time, anyway. What kind of a gadget is this? Part of the Wright brothers' first airplane? Looks uncomfortable enough. That help the back any?
Relieves the pressure quite a bit, sir.
How long, Doc say you're gonna be laid up?
A few weeks, sir.
Is it pretty painful?
Not much, sir.
I guess you don't feel much like talking.
That's okay, General. Go right ahead.
Ben.
Yes, sir.
I was just going to say, anything you want? Something I can send you?
Not a thing, General. I've got everything I need.
You just let us know if you do need anything.
Thank you, sir.
I'm gonna drop in across the hall. I'll be seeing you, Ben.
Looks like I'll have to rate you a Class A customer, Colonel. I just learned you're something extra special.
Another crack in Savage's emotional armor as Bishop shot down and killed in action, and Lieutenant Colonel Gately bails out over the English Channel and is severely injured. So you start seeing him kind of absorb the feelings of a lot of these airmen now.
The leadership's a problem. Always has been.
Haven't you got the personnel? Want me to transfer you somebody?
There's nothing wrong with our personnel. I lost Bishop and Holloman. Cobb's okay. So's Gately, and he's just out of the hospital. Takes time to know.
How long before you figure you will know?
Well, I don't know that one either. How can you be sure? How do you know what you're pushing Gately into? How do you know we didn't send Bishop up just that once too often? I don't even know how I'll know, but I'm the one that's down there, and I'll have
Frank! To... You're swinging after the bell. Tell me something, will you? What was the name of the man you relieved?
Who, Keith?
What was his trouble, do you remember? You're not propping them up, too, are you? Take a good look, Frank.
You think that?
It would be natural enough. The things you go through with a bunch of those boys, working your way out of the hole with them, it's hard not to let them get under your hide. And the one thing I've noticed on the record lately, you've been flying more missions rather than less.
Look, General. I'm the one that's got to shove them up there. And until I know that they're ready, I'm not about to turn them loose.
All right, Frank. Make it as soon as you can, will you?
You bet I will, sir.
You tell me when?
Yes, sir.
Sounds familiar, huh? Now Savage is holding on too tight.
Commander, we're hit bad, sir, in radio compartment, on fire.
Get in there and see what you can do about it. Rest of crew, hold your stations. Let's settle down.
Bowmaner to commander. Fly 12 o'clock level.
We can forget about fighters for a while. Able to Baker and Charlie Force, change of plan. Start your bomb run from Hal Steuben. Acknowledge.
Charlie leader, Wilco.
Baker leader to Able leader. We'll be bombing in a bad crosswind. Secondary target looks clear.
Able to Baker, no dice will hit the primary. Repeat, your new IP is Hal Steuben.
Roger.
To share the little extra footage here. It was great U.S. Air Force, German Luftwaffe combat footage. Remember, these B-17s had to fight their way into the target area and fight their way out of the target area against German flak, AAA, and Luftwaffe fighters. Here we see Savage taking another emotional hit when his air exec Joe Cobb's plane explodes on the way out of the target area.
Welcome to Operation Stovall.
Glad to see you, Frank. How does it look for tomorrow?
Can't tell yet. Lots of damage.
I'm sorry about Joe.
Well, that's the way it goes. Any more on the weather, Ben?
Looks okay, sir.
Good. Looks like all we got left to do is go get it done.
The old man was mighty pleased with the results, Frank.
Well, he ought to be. The strike photos looks as though tomorrow might wash it up before any good.
Did you know he went on the mission today?
No.
Slipped into Kurt May's plane. I don't think Kurt knew till he crossed the enemy coast.
When Davenport says, sorry about Joe, and Savage says, well, that's the way it goes, it speaks volumes of him suppressing his emotions for the good of the group. This is very common with military combat leaders. By the way, when Davenport said the general had slipped into the Kurt May's plane, May was actually a four-star general in the U.S. Air Force and was instrumental in building Strategic Air Command, which I thought was pretty cool.
you take it?
Here's where Savage's emotional and mental breakdown finally occurs. To better understand the strain of command, nearly 50,000 airmen lost their lives in World War II. Most were lost over Nazi Germany. A typical airman's chance of survival was less than 50%. On a particular day in the fall of 43 over Schweinfurt, Germany, 8th Air Force lost 60 B-17s just to German fighter aircraft alone. It was appropriately called Black Thursday. I have a particular affinity for B-17s because my grandfather was a gunner on them during World War II flying missions over Germany. America owes, and the world owes, a huge debt of gratitude to these brave men who flew all of those missions. I know it's black and white, but I highly encourage you to watch this movie in its entirety. Okay, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, give me a thumbs up and please subscribe to my channel. Let me know what you think in the comments below. And until next time, make sure your takeoff and landing's equal.